Welcome to Speechless. We're glad to have you here live from the SEC studios in White Bear Lake, also live over SPNN in St. Paul. We've got a full lineup for you tonight. Little review of something we talked about last week about DUI laws. Going to talk about Muslims and tuberculosis a little bit. We got a couple new appellate court judges, or one new appellate court, one new Supreme Court justice. And also a lot of articles out about a U.S. Supreme Court decision that didn't surprise me, but it should. It should surprise you, but this is how our Minnesota courts operate, and I didn't know this was going on at the U.S. Supreme Court. Well, yeah, I did. I knew it about cameras in the courtroom. So, you know, double standards going on in our court system. And then we're going to look at the at St. Paul Public Schools and the little protests going on down there. And St. Paul Public Schools is having a budget problem. And people are trying to blame it on the state not funding them enough. Just unbelievable. And if you know the history, it has nothing to do with that. It has everything to do with the incompetent management, the poor way that, and poor decisions that the St. Paul School Board and administration made. Of course, we got a new school board in St. Paul, and they're trying to fix the problem, but they're doing it the typical way of cutting visible programs rather than doing across-the-board cuts and stuff like that. They're just chopping programs. At least that's the threat anyway, but that's standard practice, and it doesn't need to be done. All right, so let's get into the show. And remember, let's put the graphics up here. You can call in with your comments and questions. If you don't want to call in, you could email me at speechlessmn@gmail.com. I may or may not get back to you. I will read it eventually. You want to watch past shows, youtube.com/speechlessmn. Last week, I talked about the new court-issued statutes on DUI law and what constitutes probable cause. And, you know, one of the features was just weaving once in your lane. And, of course, you drive anywhere. Do it. Just focus tomorrow, or if you're going out tonight, you know, when you're following somebody, see if they weave in the lane. You know, once. And then, or they make a really a right-hand turn, and it's just a little bit off. See if that happens. Well, those are two factors, and especially at night, and if you drive by a bar, those are factors that determine whether you have probable cause for being drunk driving. You know, we're turning into a police state. Well, I got a response from one of my viewers who said, ran into an article where youth are being pulled over for driving too perfectly. And the presumption is that if a youth, and especially a male youth, is driving straight, they're probably using marijuana. And then they could be pulled over. So, I mean, what is it? You know, I mean, this is the police state thing, you know. And so in the article, there was some talk about, you know, two younger guys, but in their 30s with tattoos, and they were driving perfect. So they got pulled over and don't use, you know. So it's just bizarre. What are we headed to here? You know, we don't need this. You're driving too perfectly, so you haven't done anything wrong, and you get pulled over. And if you mess up a little bit, turn your radio on or something. It's still in your lane, but you go from one side to the other, and you can get pulled over. It's terrible. And the Minnesota Supreme Court just ruled this last week. Interesting case. I don't know all the details. But there's a couple of them I have to go into. But just on the surface, State of Minnesota respondent versus Heather Leanne Horst. This is a life sentence she got. But appellant statements were admissible at trial because police investigators obtained them during a non-custodial interview. In other words, she wasn't under arrest. She wasn't a suspect. They were just interviewing her. And so whatever she said there that was able to help convict her didn't need a Miranda warning because she wasn't a suspect then. So what does that tell you? Under no circumstances, none, and this is legal advice from people who argue before the Supreme Court who do criminal defense attorney. It's on the website. Don't talk to the police. Google that. Don't ever talk to the police. And you'll find these lawyers and police officers saying, don't talk to us. I'm going to try to get you to talk to us. But if you're going to protect your liberties, don't talk to us, because things may get twisted out of whack, things that we don't even have control over. So your best bet, lawyer up, don't talk to us. So even if you're not under arrest, not under the threat of arrest, whatever, you just can't talk to the police anymore. We've turned into a police state. Well, you know they're going to come up with something that's you can't, you know, if you don't talk to us, that's a crime. Well, you know, lawyer up. I want to talk to my attorney. That's what you got to do. Another point. Exigent circumstances justified the warrantless seizure of the appellant's cell phone. Okay. Even if the district court erred when it approved the search warrants for the appellant's medical records, any error was harmless beyond a reasonable doubt. Even if the district court erred when it failed to give an accomplice corroboration jury instruction sua sponte, any error did not affect the appellant's substantial rights. So, you know, as a comedy of errors in a person's driving or circumstances or accumulation of circumstances in your driving can get you pulled over and arrested for drunk driving, an accumulation of errors by the court is meaningless. It's just, anyway, what are we coming to here? All right, let's move on to this issue of refugees. Of course, you know, we're bringing refugees, and specifically Muslim refugees, into our cities. And, boy, there's a lot moving into Minnesota. And I had the numbers in front of me, and I don't have them right now. But what's happening is they're saying in about 22%, and this was on Breitbart, 22% of resettled refugees in Minnesota test positive for tuberculosis. Now, if you're at the, so they're being tested, but after they're coming in here and they are getting treated, but tuberculosis is a serious problem. Now, in our workhouse here in Ramsey County, you get tested coming in and you get tested going out and checked going out because someone got tuberculosis in just the health conditions of the Ramsey County workhouse, and they had a big lawsuit, and Ramsey County had to pay out a lot of money. But the whole point to me is, you know, the federal government is supposed to be watching out for our safety, okay, and our health. And immigrants are supposed to be checked before they come in, and they're not doing it. They're checking them after they're doing it. And, you know, in the 6th Congressional District, and also Keith Ellison, representative from the 5th Congressional District, Tom Emmer is ignoring the refugee problem as much as I can tell, and only A.J. Kern, who is running against Tom Emmer for the Republican primary, is addressing the refugee crisis we have in Minnesota and the basically the taking over of our state by the Muslim community. Don't be fooled, people. The ultimate goal of the Muslim community is to take over the state of Minnesota and the United States. That's their religious beliefs. I mean, so just, and we're talking take over, not like Christians who, the goal isn't to take over, the goal is to share Christ and have Christ change lives. And it's just a different dynamic, and a lot of people don't want to get that because they get a lot of money by bringing them in. Who benefits? The social programs, the people that work for the social programs, the real estate developers. You got now an extra, you know, 100,000 people living in Minnesota because of the refugee situation. And where do they live? In developments, in houses, in apartments. So it keeps the value of the real estate higher. That's one of the reasons they're coming in. So one person commented, a friend commented on Facebook saying, something's really wrong. Our state flipped out with 2 cases of the measles and demanded all school kids get vaccination booster shots, and nothing came of it. In other words, the measles things didn't spread. Here we have 150 specifically identified cases of TB coming from foreigners in my state, almost exclusively traced back to Somalis. No local media coverage at all. Isn't this highly contagious and being suppressed to keep the immigrants and big federal grant dollars flowing? A.J. Kern is right, Tom Emmer and Keith Ellison and the Muslims are wrong. Interesting comments on Facebook, and I would have to agree with that. But they're here, get them help, and solve the problem over in Somalia. You know, help these people live and have their liberties in the country they're from. Export our Constitution to other countries. Instead, what's happening is we're taking in people who want to get rid of our Constitution and want to get rid of our liberties. All right. Minnesota Supreme Court. Okay, we got 2 new justices, or 1 new justice. Margaret Chudich was sworn in as the 93rd Supreme Court Justice, and Diane Bratvold sworn as the 54th Court of Appeals Judge. So in the Minnesota Supreme Court, there's just been a huge change shifting going on here. People resigning, people get appointed to federal branch. So people are coming in and going, elections taking place. And we have another justice resigning, Justice Dietzen, and I think Chertich is taking the place of Wilhelmina Wright. And so she was appointed up to the Supreme Court, then went to federal court. Just a lot of switching around going on. Dietzen now has resigned, okay, as of the end of August. And so Dayton's going to appoint somebody there. This was a foul play by Justice Dietzen. And the Minnesota lawyer wrote up this article, oh, what a nonpartisan move, what a move of generosity to show the independence of the judiciary. And so Governor Dayton could appoint a justice to the Supreme Court. Well, what's happening right now is we're going to have a shift from a Republican majority Supreme Court, although I doubt that it really is because I don't think Dietzen was a Republican, and neither some of the other justices, to a DFL Supreme Court. Okay, so once Dietzen's gone, somebody's appointed, we have a 5-4 DFL majority based by who's been appointed. But now there's an election coming up because Justice Hudson, who was just appointed to the Supreme Court, is up for election. Well, she was appointed about 2 years ago, so she's up for election. And as of right now, we know of at least one person who is running against her, and that's Michelle McDonald. Now, Michelle McDonald ran 2 years ago. A lot of self-induced distraction controversy from the Republican Party over Michelle McDonald. I should say the Republican Party insiders, elitists, administration. The people wanted Michelle to run. She got endorsed. And the administration shut her down. Well, she sought endorsement again. And again, the Committee on Judicial Elections recommended Michelle McDonald put her name forward. In other words, Michelle wanted to run. She's qualified. The committee has no concern about any of the legal stuff. It's in the past. The Grazini-Ruckey divorce case and the girls that ran away is not a concern because Michelle didn't even know anything about it. She didn't even come on the case until after three other attorneys took about $1 million of Sandra Grazini's money to defend her over a two-year period and did nothing for her. And Michelle comes on board 6 months after the girls are missing and gets paid nothing. And so this concept that, well, Michelle's going to be charged criminally, well, you have attorney-client privilege. All right, oh yeah, Minnesota, we don't have attorney-client privilege. I forgot that. The courts don't allow that in Minnesota. Well, they allow it on a selective basis. Okay, that's the deal. I mean, our courts are so screwed up, it's unbelievable. So, attorney-client privilege, but she didn't know. And so somehow people are thinking, well, Michelle McDonald might get charged with a crime. Well, no. She's representing somebody, and she was never told. So, and the same with her campaign manager, who was also charged with deprivation of parental rights. Michelle did not know Dee Dee Evavold until 6 months after the two children ran away. But there's a whole different scenario being presented out there that Michelle was Sandra Grazini's rookie from the very beginning, and it's not true. Not true at all. Matter of fact, get this. Get why being an attorney is a pretty good gig if you get the right client. And I got a lot more work to do with this, but Catherine Graves first got a $5,000 down payment. That's reasonable. You know, nothing surprising there. Uncontested divorce. Had a phone conversation with the Grazini-Ruckey's husband and parents about the divorce and about the agreement, on the phone getting vehicle identification numbers. And Judge David Knutson, when David Ruckey came back and said, and his story is he didn't know, but when David Ruckey came back and said, hey, this was fraud, I didn't know I was getting a divorce, the Judge David Knutson wouldn't let the evidence in that there was this phone conversation and we got the phone numbers and here's how long it took, and wouldn't let the evidence in that here's David Ruckey reading the court, the divorce document in front of a notary, wouldn't let the bank videotape in, wouldn't let the teller, the notary be subpoenaed to testify that David Ruckey had signed this and was and his observations of what David did with the document. Wouldn't let that in. So you have a lot of that going on where Judge David Knudsen just wouldn't let evidence in for whatever reason, but judges do that. They're not supposed to. They can judge on the relevance, but that's also up to the jury to decide. But it wasn't a crime. It was civil law. So judges can just rule however they want. Anyway, for 4 months of work, Catherine Graves got $80,000 and then split halfway through the trial. Walked in, had a meeting, backroom meeting. And why are we having backroom meetings with these justices? These attorneys go into the back room and discuss things. And the client's not there. That's wrong. But one of these meetings took place. The attorney, Scruzzini Ruckey's attorney, walked out and said, "All right, that's it. We're done. Case is done." Or, you know, judge says it's over. Well, did Sandra Scruzzini Ruckey get to present her evidence? Get to present her defense? Didn't happen. But it's done. That's the type of thing that's been going on over and over in this case. One attorney, Linda Olaf, she got over $450,000, spent less than a year on the case. Maybe a day in the courtroom. You know, and these attorneys, you know, $225,000, you know, a down payment, and then later on, you know, you got to pay up another $225,000 or we're out and we're going to call it irreconcilable differences and, you know, just pay the money. Well, you know, Sanders should have gotten some ethical attorneys, but that's what she was told. These were ethical attorneys. That's a lot of money. Then she had Lisa Henry. Lisa Henry was paid $80,000 retainer, and then had to pay another $150,000 and $25,000 and $75,000 here and there, and Lisa Henry only spent 15 minutes in court, and then when they had the special guardian ad litem psychologist emergency phone call to get the children out of Sandra's care, the phone call and the conversation and the time the psychologist spent with the kids, you know, the whole thing was probably less than 2 hours. I mean, the court hearing was over the phone. Sandra wasn't even there. She wasn't allowed to be there. And in a 3-hour period, she had to be out of her house and only can take a suitcase worth of clothes. So, you know, so much for having any rights. You think you have a home? You don't have a home. The court can take it at any time if they want. Okay, so my point there. I forgot my point. I'll figure it out eventually. The court. So we got some new justices, Michelle McDonald, the court problems going on there. What the problem is, Michelle's exposing the problem with the courts. That's Michelle's problem, because the elite judiciary doesn't want them exposed. And I bring this to mind because John Whitehead of the Rutherford Institute came out with an article. There's a order that didn't take place. There was an opinion that didn't take place in the U.S. Supreme Court because it was denied. And the opinion is stunning. The denial of the opinion is stunning, okay? Here's John Whitehead in his quote, "The vitality of civil and political institutions," or John Whitehead's quoting Justice William Douglas, "the vitality of civil and political institutions in our society depends on free discussion. It is only through free debate and free exchange of ideas that government remains responsive to the will of the people and peaceful change is effected. The right to speak freely and to promote diversity of ideas and programs is therefore one of the chief distinctions that sets us apart from totalitarian regimes. And of course, that's where a lot of our college campuses are becoming, totalitarian regimes, where you have to have politically correct speech. Well, John Whitehead says, shame on the U.S. Supreme Court for making a mockery of the First Amendment. Well, why would he say that? What's being mocked? All the justices had to do was right a 60-year wrong and make it illegal to exercise one's First Amendment rights on the Supreme Court plaza. It shouldn't have been a big deal. After all, this is the court that has historically championed a robust First Amendment, no matter how controversial or politically incorrect. Over the course of its 227-year history, the Supreme Court has defended the free speech rights of the Ku Klux Klan, crossburners, Communist Party organizer, military imposters, Westboro Baptist Church members shouting gay slurs at the military funeral, a teenager who burned a cross on the lawn of an African-American family, swastika-swearing Nazis marching through the predominantly Jewish downtown of Skokie, abortion protesters and sidewalk counselors in front of abortion clinics, flag burners, anti-war activists arrested for wearing a jacket bearing the swear words, the draft, high school students wearing black armbands to school in protest of the Vietnam War, a film producer who created and sold videotapes of dogfights, a movie theater that showed a sexually explicit film, and the Boy Scouts of America to exclude gay members, among others. Okay, I'm setting you up for the finale here. What did the Supreme Court do to deny free speech rights? Basically, the Supreme Court has historically had no problem with radical and reactionary speech, false speech, hateful speech, racist speech on front lawns, offensive speech at funerals, anti-Semitic speech in parades, anti-abortion, pro-life speech in front of abortion clinics, inflammatory speech in a Chicago auditorium, political speech in a private California shopping mall, or offensive speech in a state courthouse. So when activist Harold Hodge appealed to the U.S. Supreme Court to defend his right to stand on the Supreme Court's government plaza, and silently protest the treatment of African Americans and Hispanics by police, it should have been a no-brainer, unanimous ruling in favor of hearing his case. They should have heard his case. Unfortunately, the Supreme Court is not quite as keen on the idea of a robust First Amendment as it used to be, especially when that right is being exercised on the court's own front porch. Free speech everywhere, but not on the front porch of the U.S. Supreme Court. Not only did the court refuse to hear Hodges' appeal, but in doing so, it upheld the 60-year-old law banning expressive activity on the Supreme Court plaza. Mind you, this was the same ban that a federal district court judge described as unreasonable, substantially overbroad, irreconcilable with the First Amendment, plainly unconstitutional on its face, and repugnant to the Constitution. A federal district court judge said that. Wow, what a slap, you know, to the U.S. Supreme Court. Well, one day after the district court judge Beryl H. Howell issued her strongly worded opinion striking down the federal statute, the marshal for the Supreme Court, with the approval of Chief Justice John Roberts, issued even more strident regulations outlawing expressive activity on the grounds of the high court, including the plaza. Talk about a double standard. A double standard upheld by the federal appeals court. So the district court said, nah, that's unconstitutional. This is a bold-faced slap in the face to the U.S. Constitution and free speech rights. The appellate court overturned that decision, and the U.S. Supreme Court upheld the appellate court's decision by not taking the case. You know, and what is the appellate court's rationale for enforcing this ban on expressive activity on the Supreme Court's plaza? Allowing demonstrations directed at the court on the court's own front terrace would tend to yield the impression of a court engaged with and potentially vulnerable to outside entreaties by the public. You want to translate that? Here's John Whitehead's translation. The appellate court that issued that particular ruling in Hodge versus Talkin actually wants us to believe that the court is so impressionable that the justice could be swayed by the slight sight of a single man standing alone and silent in a 20,000 square foot space wearing a small sign on a day when the court was not in session. And John Whitehead says, what a load of tripe. And that's what we have. And of course, the U.S. Supreme Court won't allow a camera in the courtroom. I mean, that tells you everything right there. It's nine justices that are professional with attorneys that are professionals that wouldn't even know that the court exists, that the cameras exist. Of course, they'd know the court exists, but wouldn't know that the cameras exist there, and you can't have it. So much for freedom of the press. This is a sickness in there. This is a sickness in our district courts, and it's a sickness in our Minnesota courts. Yeah, we can have a camera for the Supreme Court. We can have a camera for the appellate court, but they won't film the appellate court. You got to go film it. I mean, you know, and when you really look at it, they're concerned about their image. That's the real issue. You know it. You see it. What's somebody going to think about me? Now, some of them aren't that way. I don't think Judge Ross is that way. You know, he was certainly speaking his mind. Maybe others don't. But you know what? Get over it. Read your Constitution. And enable freedom of the press to take place. But we won't do that in the district court. Now, ABC has asked to go in and film the Grazzini-Ruckey trial that's coming up. I'm going to ask also, piggyback on that, to film that. We'll see what the court does. But their answer is, well, there's no, you know, a public trial just means you can, you know, public can come in. It doesn't mean that you can take the picture out to the public so that they can see it. You know, that's insane. You know, that was Michelle McDonald's appeal. She wanted the press to come in and the court refused, and so she appealed it. She didn't have a right to public trial. Well, I mean, it's new groundwork. But why shouldn't the cameras be there? Well, the answer to that is, well, we need to have a fair trial. The defendant has a right to a fair trial. And the court is saying that because the cameras are there, they may not get a fair trial. Well, wait a second. The U.S. Constitution says you have the right of the press, and I'm video press, ABC's video press. That's how I do my form of media, as we'll see here. And actually, it tells a better story than having to listen to me tell the story. That's why I try to have a lot more video than me talking. It doesn't always work out like today, but I'm video press. And what they're saying is because of the camera, a person might not get a fair trial. Well, our Constitution and the reason it was written and the way it was written was such that having a public trial and having the freedom of the press guarantees more of a fair trial than if you didn't have it. And the issue of a public trial was because people were going into back rooms and judges were making decisions without other people seeing it, where the press couldn't get in and report on it. And what better way to have a fair trial than to let people see the trial? The actual trial, rather than being filtered through me or somebody else, because people change the story or people don't get the story right and they may not understand, whatever. It just doesn't matter. We have a free press. Douglas's statements here in John Whitehead's article. It's a great article. But let's have the freedom of the press, the video press. Free the video press. You know how many people have had their lives of 10, 15, 20 years in jail or 2 months in jail because there was a video that showed that the police were lying. We've had them on our show. How many people were saved thousands of dollars of fines and a bad reputation and loss of job if there wasn't for a video being there to show that the police were lying? And of course, you would have loved the McDonald case when the cross-examination of the police officer when she was pulled over for speeding and smelled a slight smell of alcohol. Well, did they? How do you know they're not lying? We don't know. Oh, we got to trust the police. No, we got to verify the police. We got to verify everything. You got to verify what I say. So, I forgot my point again. Forgetting my point. It's called preparation. All right, so. Oh. The videotape and the testimony of the police officer. You would have heard the police officer. Here's my point. The police officer was asked, "You said Michelle McDonald was under arrest." "Yes, I did. Was she under arrest?" "No." "Well, then why did you say she was under arrest when she wasn't under arrest?" "Because I wanted to pull her out of the car." "But Michelle McDonald's an attorney. She knew she wasn't under arrest, and she didn't have to leave the car." So wouldn't that create confusion when you're lying to her about getting out of she being under arrest when she knows she's not under arrest? Well, it could. This is my interpretation. Read the actual words once I get the transcript. "Well, I just wanted her to get out of the car, so I said she was under arrest." And so now she gets charged with resisting arrest for which she wasn't arrested. Wouldn't you like to see that conversation? And the Dakota County Courts and the Minnesota Supreme Court, appellate courts, right now in the Minnesota Supreme Court, because of their rules that aren't statutes, we've got to get on the legislature to pass a law on this to have them change the statutes. I mean, it's bad, folks. It's really bad. And this has been going on for years and years and years, this behind-the-scenes backroom dealing. No more backroom meetings with the judge without the client present and without the public present. Can't do that anymore. That's why Minnesota is one of the most corrupt judiciaries in the United States. And they hide it. You know, all the judges, you know, the black robe cult, the judicial cult that we have going on in Minnesota, saying, "Oh, we're so good. Everybody recognizes us as being so great." Because you lie about it, you cover it up, and you do everything you can do to cover it up. Unless it's just too obvious out there of what's going on. You know, you as a citizen, with all your rights, if you mess up, you got to pay. But our public servants, if they mess up, violate our constitutional rights, they don't have to pay. And it's a lot harder to make them pay. All right, St. Paul Public Schools. We got about 18 minutes to cover this. Parents had a rally at the St. Paul Public Schools. We're going to be showing some videos about this. But basically, St. Paul Public Schools got a $15 million shortfall. What created that shortfall? Well, the current administration and prior school board thought they were everything to the world, and nothing could go wrong, and nothing could harm them. And then they established this transgender bathroom policy, and people fled the district. And all of a sudden now, St. Paul Public Schools is landing $15 million short in their budget. So they got to fix it. And typically what happens when there's a short budget, they go after the high profile classes, music, sports, extracurricular things to, you know, we're going to just shut all those down. And that will really get the people saying, hey, the legislature, you're the problem. Well, I'm just going to first show a couple clips on the rally here that took place. So let's show the first one there. There's some pretty good statements that were made. Let's play it.
You might have heard the expression mansplaining, okay? It's condescending, it tells you what you already know, right? Well, we've had enough of Silvasplaining. So let's explain one thing to the people in the building very clearly so they understand. No cuts to kids.
No cuts to kids. No cuts to kids. No cuts to kids. No cuts to kids. No cuts to kids. No cuts to kids.
All right. Well, there were about 150, 200 people there, parents and kids at the protest. You know what was really interesting? Well, I like this Silvasplaining. That was pretty good, pretty creative. The condescending talk, and it really came out with the transgender bathroom bill. You know, and like The solution is simple. Now, Target has bathrooms for families. So the transgenders, they can go in and use those bathrooms and not bother the privacy of the women or the men. They can use their own restroom in Target, but Target establishes pride policy. Well, who cares? Well, St. Paul Public Schools can do the same thing. They can have individual bathroom stalls where the transgender can go in. And everybody maintains their privacy. But no, we're not going to do that. We're going to force our ideology on you and take away your right to privacy. It's a fascinating thing. So this dictation by Silva, and people are tired of it. This being treated bad by her and talked down to and condescended to. Okay, let's go to the next video.
Not for the sheer skill and cultural importance, than for the fact that we know that music improves math skills. The ancient Greeks knew this. Why Superintendent Silva doesn't is beyond me.
Yeah, I mean, if the ancient Greeks figured that out long ago, why can't we still do it today? And it's kind of same thing with the Common Core. You don't need to change what works. You don't need to make things more calculated. You don't need to add more calculations when it can be a simple answer, a simple calculation. Don't make it complex. Don't make it harder than it needs to be. And so these are basic things we should understand. We don't need to change math because it's been working for thousands of years and hundreds of years. And the basics don't change at the elementary and grade school level. Okay, and really in my mind, the Common Core is being used to dumb people down. Well, we'll go to the next speaker here, and you get this same old tired philosophy of the state's not paying enough. So let's hear what he has to say.
Members and district, my name is Bob Spalding. I'm an SPPS parent, and like many of you in this room, I share deep concern about the budget and the loss of specialist positions and electives across the district. There are so many reasons for the budget shortfall, and I agree that we should be looking at ways to cut things like administration if we can. I suspect there are practical and mathematical limits to that approach as well. I agree that we should want to slow the loss of students from our district and turn the flat net enrollment of recent years into net enrollment gains. When it comes to sustainable funding of our schools, we must not lose sight of one of the most important sources of revenue, the state of Minnesota. In the May 7th Star Tribune, three board members from other districts in the metro area underscored the legislature's shrinking commitment to our schools. Here's how their commentary applies to St. Paul. $15 million, as you know, that's next year's budget shortfall in St. Paul. That may sound big, but that number pales in comparison with the state's dwindling commitment to our kids in schools. $22 million, that's the money St. Paul kids would get every year if the state funding formula had kept pace with 2003 levels. $34 million, that's the extra money St. Paul kids would get every year if the state stopped underfunding St. Paul's special education program, forcing our district to make up the difference. And they need to be held accountable. According to a 2013 MinnPost article, lawmakers did this, quote, to obscure the extent of defunding of our schools, end quote. Lawmakers, quote, lawmakers quickly learned there's no political profit in addressing it, as former Senator Mindy Greiling told MinnPost. $56 million compared to the $15 million we're talking about. By these calculations, the $56 million is the minimum the state is shortchanging St. Paul kids in schools next year, roughly four times more than the district's projected shortfall. Who's responsible for that? The legislature and the governor. Let's write them, call them, and pack their meetings and hold rallies at the Capitol. As we speak, the legislature is ending the final days of the session. Right now is when deals get made. Now we can... Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
Time's up. Time is up. Good thing they didn't send the police after him. Oh, yeah, this rally, parents, kids, peaceful rally. And remember the hockey game that broke out at the school board meeting 2 months ago? I mean the fight, the protesting, and the disorderly conducts. You know, at that meeting, there was very few police. And here you have a planned protest, rally, peaceful, and you have, there was a ton, I don't know, 15 to 20 police officers there, when usually there's maybe two or three at a school board meeting. You know, it's just, you know, maybe there was going to be a counter protest or they thought there might be one and then there'd be problem. But it's just weird. I mean, it's just the world's backwards and how things are happening and how things are perceived. But here's the problem with Mr. Spalding's thought process. The St. Paul School Board established a budget, okay? And they made projections based on how many students were going to be there. And their projections were wrong. That's why you have the shortfall. Because you have levies, you have ways to tax, you know how much money you're going to bring in, but if you miss on your projections of how many students, you're going to fail. And you should have figured out and you should have known that parents would leave the school district when you start establishing illogical policies regarding transgender. You just can't do that type of thing. I realize that the community talk, the political correct talk, the minority talk about transgender issues and gay rights and stuff like that, that they have loud voices. And, you know, I mean, I don't know if you've seen the video. You walk on a college campus and I'll be, I'm a 6 foot guy, big build, you know. And if I go up to somebody and say, you know what, I'm 5 feet, 5 inches tall. I'm a black woman, a black Hispanic woman with disabilities. And the students there can't say, no, you're not, you know. Or a guy can say, I'm a 6'5 Chinese woman. And the students are incapable of saying, no, you're not. Our education system has taken reason out, objectivity out, okay? And so how could you not have a be underfunded when you're not dealing reasonable and rightly? So even if you had the $56 million, Mr. Spaulding, which I thought your speech was great, it's a good sales job. Even if you had the $56 million, guess what? You still wouldn't have enough money. Wouldn't have it. Okay. So, yes, cut administration. No administrator left behind is a school policy. You need to cut administration. You're way over bloated. Get it cut and move on. Okay, but then make a realistic projections on your budget. And you're now going to have to face some, don't do that. Don't play this game. Oh, we got to cut music. Oh, we got to cut sports. And yeah, baloney. You don't need to. Okay. Because they only allow 45 minutes for comments down there, I was going to make some comments, but it's been 2 months now where I haven't been allowed to. But I got this, this letter came out by Michelle Critella, president of the American College of Pediatricians. And she has some strong statements about the transgender issue going on in human sexuality in our public schools and what's happening to our children. This is appalling, what she's saying here, and I'm just going to have to summarize it real quick because we don't have time. But she makes some very clear statements about how things really are. You know, when you deal with science rather than feelings, you got to deal with the reality of what you see in front of you. Otherwise, your science isn't going to work. Same with engineering. Of course, let's not teach that in our schools or make sure the kids don't have any foundation for this. Human sexuality is an objective biological binary trait. XY and XX are genetic markers of health, not genetic markers of a disorder. In other words, the language of the transgender community is this: I'm born with XX, or I'm born with XY, but I feel like I'm the opposite sex. Therefore, how I am born is a marker. How I'm feeling is what I really am, and my chromosomes are the disorder. See how twisted people get? Okay. Number two, no one is born with a gender. Everyone is born with a biological sex. Gender and awareness and sense of one's self as male or female. Okay, that's what gender is, an awareness and sense of oneself as male or female, is a sociological and psychological concept, not an objective biological one. Okay, so in other words, it's what's going on in your head when you start talking about gender. Okay, it's not a biological concept. You are what you are by birth, and your chromosomes define that. A person's belief that he or she is something they are not is, at best, a sign of confused thinking. Now, you're an amen on that. It's confused thinking, at best. According to the DSM-5, as many as 98% of gender-confused boys and 88% of gender-confused girls eventually accept their biological sex after naturally passing through puberty. And that's a great thing. But it gets worse down the road. Children who use puberty blockers, what? There's puberty blockers out there? To impersonate the opposite sex will require cross-sex hormones in later adolescence. Cross-sex hormones, testosterone and estrogen, are associated with dangerous health risks, including but not limited to high blood pressure, blood clots, stroke, and cancer. So parents are giving these kids, or guardians, puberty blockers to help them, their minds, deal with and their body be in sync with their minds. That's not a good thing. That's not good for kids. Not at all. But these are being fed and given these drugs to these kids. Rates of suicide are 20 times higher among adults who use cross-sex hormones and undergo sex reassignment surgery, even in Sweden, which is among the most LGBTQ-affirming countries. Is that compassionate? All right, big last one. Conditioning children to believe that a lifetime of chemical and surgical impersonations of the opposite sex is normal and healthful is child abuse. And parents that are doing this, you're abusing your children, in my opinion. And this pediatrician, head of the president of the American College of Pediatricians, the vice president of the American College of Pediatricians, and distinguished service professor of psychiatry at Johns Hopkins Medical School and former psychiatrist in chief at Johns Hopkins Medical School. All agree to that statement. All right, remember, if you don't stand up for other people's liberties, who's going to stand up for yours? And good men don't do nothing. God bless. Have a great day. Sets on fire.